Hi, and welcome to another video. In this video, we are going to add a few more tools to our toolkit of analyzing rational functions, both graphically and algebraically, in order to culminate in the next video of putting it all together and graphing, full-on graphing a rational function from an equation. But to do that, we need a few more things. Now, in previous videos, we've looked at vertical asymptotes and horizontal asymptotes. Right, vertical asymptotes are about domain, and horizontal asymptotes are about end behavior. So to get this new, to motivate the new thing, I want to compare two rational functions that I've drawn here. And they should look somewhat familiar. We saw in the previous videos, not this exact function, but 1 over x squared. And if you just see what's changed here, it's still 1 over something squared, but instead of x, we have x plus 2. So this is almost like a transformation of 1 over x squared, inserting x plus 2 here, which, if you look at the shape of the graph we had, and the shape of the graph we have here, it's shifted that original function, that original graph, 2 to the left, just like any insertion of x plus 2 at the input would do. So, this is our graph of 1 over x plus 2 squared. Now, and worth commenting on, by that shift, that horizontal shift, the domain restriction has changed. I hope that's fair. 0 is no longer a problem here because 0 plus 2 squared is 2. We get something, not 0. So what's the domain restriction now? It's negative 2, because negative 2 plus 2 is 0. Can't divide by 0. So notice that in the original function 1 over x squared, we had our vertical asymptote, our sort of behavior, at y equals 0 previously. X equals 0. Y-axis. That was our vertical asymptote. But it's not there anymore. It has moved. It has moved over to x equals negative 2. This is the vertical asymptote of this graph. And it's moved because the domain has shifted because the function has changed. Alright. And before we go over there, I also want to comment that we can also see here that the end behavior, or the horizontal asymptote, has not changed. The graph is still sort of settling on the x-axis, say y because I mean on the line y equals 0. Why is that happening? Degree 0, degree 2, in that previous video where we compared degrees of our numerator and denominator, that's that rule where it says if this is smaller than this, we always get this horizontal asymptote. So there's just some familiar pieces, even though this is somewhat of a new graph. But I do want to compare it now. Look at how this function and this function are not the same, or are almost the same, but different in some way. This has 1 over x plus 2, just like this. But this one is being squared here. This one is not being squared. So the thing I want to comment on is the domain of this function is the same as the domain of this function. X cannot be negative 2. So what do we see, how do our graphs relate? The vertical asymptote in both of them is x is negative 2. In other words, it's shifted by 2. That's our vertical asymptote on both functions. Even though they're not exactly the same, that is still true because that is tied, as always, to domain restrictions. So there is still that evidence. Also, what do we see in common? Degree on the top is implicitly 0 for a constant. Degree of the denominator, oh, it's not 2 anymore. What's the implied power down here? It's implied power 1, so it's like here n is 0 and m is 1. We haven't seen that combination, but it's still the relationship of n being smaller is enough to lock in the fact that the horizontal asymptote should be y equals 0. And it is, just as we've seen. So these functions have the same vertical asymptote slash domain and the same horizontal asymptote. But where are they different? They're different in the, you can see, they're exactly the same here, but over here, the function as it approaches its vertical asymptote from the left, it's going up. Here, as it approaches its vertical asymptote from the left, and again, what I mean is getting closer and closer to the dotted line from the left, it's going down. Why is that happening? Why didn't that happen here? These x values, just to pick a few, are to the left of negative 2, to the left of the domain break. So for example, negative 3 is one of them. If we just quickly play that through, take negative 3 in here. Just one example will suffice. What are we going to get? Positive, and negative 3 plus 2 is negative 1, positive divided by a negative, which is a negative. So we should get a negative output, a negative y value. And as long as we're in the realm of x values that are over here, to the left of negative 2, any of them plus 2 is going to land negative, meaning you're going to get negative outputs. And why didn't that happen over here? Because even with x values that were that would have made this part negative, we squared it after the fact, and that eliminated the negative. So this is an important distinction because we haven't focused on it, but you can identify the main restrictions, you know, pretty straightforwardly using factoring if necessary, of rational functions. What we haven't talked about until now is that it's the exponent on around each of the vertical asymptotes, and we haven't seen them yet, but there are plenty of functions out there. We haven't graphed them yet. Plenty of functions with multiple vertical asymptotes for every distinct factor that we can make zero. But the idea here is that the power here is 2, and the power here is 1, around the same denominator. And what I want to stress is this is related to the idea of multiplicity that we saw in polynomial videos, but here's the difference. When you have an asymptote tied to a denominator with an even power on it, what you should expect to see is, on either side of the asymptote, the behavior of the function is going to be mirrored. In other words, it's going up here, so it's going up here. In another function, we might see this, you know, imagine a vertical transformation on this. Imagine a reflection over the x-axis. We could actually, how would I get that? Just throw in a negative. If I did that, this graph would flip down, and both of these pieces going up would now both be headed down, but they'd both be headed down. They'd be doing the same thing on each side of the vertical asymptote. And that's what I'm trying to stress here, is that when you have an even exponent on a factor in your denominator, vertical asymptote, the behavior of the function of where f of x is going, where y is going, is mirrored like this. Now what about over here? What's the power on our denominator piece? It's not even, it's odd, it's a power of 1, multiplicity of 1, you might say. How did that change the graph? Well, we could say, just to bring in the notation, the vertical asymptote is negative 2, so as x goes to negative 2 from the left, means from the left, where are the y values going? Where is g going? Down, 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 negative infinity, right? But that looks okay. My writing's not level. But what about approaching this dotted line from the right side? We're saying as x goes to negative 2 from the right, what's the function doing? What are the y values doing? Getting bigger and bigger. So while you look at that, I want to write the same version over here for f. Oops, not negative infinity. We're not just in end behavior here, we're back in vertical asymptote. And so we're talking about as x gets close to its vertical asymptote at negative 2 from the left and from the right, what's the function f doing? Negative, coming towards negative 2 from the left, it's going up. Coming towards negative 2 from the right, it's going also up. So see the difference in this the notation that we've seen before. This is from a previous video, we saw this. For this function, because that power of 2 is there, as we approach our vertical asymptote, the function is doing the same thing on both sides. It's going up in both directions in this case. But over here, because of that power of 1, as we get closer and closer to our vertical asymptote on each side, the outputs are doing different behaviors. It's going down on the left and up on the right. And that's just really all you need to keep in mind is, in general, when we go into graphing or trying to make a sketch of a rational function, we can use the exponents or the multiplicities of the factored pieces in our denominator, which we know are connected to vertical asymptotes, to make predictions about will they go one direction and then the other direction around that vertical asymptote, or will their behavior sort of mirror like this? And it all has to do with, is it a power, an odd power, or an even power? And most, for the most time part, we'll just be saying powers of either one or two, but if it's one or odd, you should expect this alternation around the vertical asymptote. If it's two or an even, you should expect this mirroring. In other words, it didn't flip down. It went up here, and it went up here. That is always going to be, and that's what we might, you know, informally call the multiplicity effect all around vertical asymptotes. So that's one new tool to consider. All right. So let me click now. With that all said, I'm going to clear these graphs so we can do a little bit more analysis. A little few more tools. We may sketch some more graphs, but they'll just be sketches. So now let's look at a function, and I'm going to give you a rational function. Unlike the most ones we've looked at, let's say h of x, I'm going to give it to you in fully factored form already. So, as I hope I've stressed previously, why do we love factoring so much? Because, well, let me write the function before I say 2x plus 1. X minus 5, two factors, over parentheses x minus 5 and x plus 6. So before I comment on the new stuff, I just want to, again, appreciate or stress our appreciation for factor form. Why is this so nice? Because it gives us, like, x-ray vision. We can see a lot going on here. We can see right away what is our first concern? Possible domain restrictions. Any numbers or inputs that would make the denominator zero can be seen, because if we make this factor zero, it doesn't matter what this is. If we can make this factor zero, same thing. So, we can record that the domain, well, what can x not be? 5 or negative 6, right? So x cannot be, this is going to be true for the rest of the life of this function. Those numbers are out of the domain. Full stop. And no others, because we have a factor denominator and we have no other vectors. So those are the only ones. But it's really nice to have factored form. Now what else can we glean from this rational function written in this way? Even though it's not FOIL'd, we know a little bit about degree now. We know that when we're interested in degree, we're shifting gears to horizontal asymptotes and end behavior. So without fully FOILing, I'll make this claim. If you FOILed your denominator out, at some point this x and this x would multiply, making an x squared. And every other distribution piece would be something less than that, so this one would have an x squared at the head of the column, and that would be its leading term, 1x squared. What would happen if we fully FOILed this? This 2x would multiply by this x, making 2x squared, and then we'd distribute, and I'm going to claim that nothing would be, there'd be no larger piece 2x squared there. Again, there is more to the rational function than just those terms, but just by kind of peering through and imagining the FOIL, we can conjecture that the largest, the lead term of the numerator would be 2x squared, and the lead term of the denominator would be 1x squared. Hopefully that's reasonable. Why is that helpful? Even in this form, that's enough. We said in the last video that what determines end behavior in horizontal asymptotes is really just those lead terms. Nothing else will matter as x gets large or small. So we look at the degrees, 2 and 2, this is the case n being equal to m, which we discussed previously, and that means that the horizontal asymptote of this function, without looking at a graph, is the ratio of the coefficients. What are they? 2 and 1. It will be at y equals 2. So already we have a nice sort of expectation, and what I'm going to do is, I'm going to mock up a very informal graph, because I'm not aiming for perfection, and I'm not aiming to fully graph this, but I do want to show you how to start to construct, or help yourself construct, graphs of rational functions. A doesn't have to be a perfect fist, it's just a good example. To start with, a horizontal asymptote is a horizontal line, right? So we saw this a little bit previously, but we mark that up by putting a horizontal line in at this equation. Here's two, so something like this. That horizontal line is going to serve as the cradle or the seat of the function. We should expect it to sort of sit in some way on that line, as we've seen with horizontal asymptotes. Now, I want to hold on vertical asymptotes because there is something more to say about this, but with what we know so far, what might we conjecture are the vertical asymptotes here? Because remember, those are all about domain restrictions. Can't divide by zero, so it seems like 5 could be a vertical asymptote, and so could negative 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I need more graph. 3, 4, 5, minus 6. So, I guess I'll put these down. So, in general, horizontal asymptotes are marked as horizontal dotted lines. We'll mark vertical asymptotes. We've seen this. Oh, I'm forgetting. In the two graphs you saw a moment ago, you saw the vertical dotted lines representing the vertical asymptotes. And that's always the way. Horizontal dotted lines for horizontal asymptotes and vertical ones for vertical asymptotes. So we'd like to put those down, a vertical asymptote, I think, a vertical dotted line for each of these numbers. But before we do that, I want to acknowledge what you may have been staring at, which is that this factored form has a match pair, a matching factor on top and bottom of x minus 5. And algebraically, you might have the instinct to say, well, don't those cancel? And the answer is yes, they do. So what is the simplified function? H of x simplifies to 2x plus 1 over x plus 6. Now in the video we talked about, and in general, we've talked about this previously, that when you simplify a rational function and simplify a term out of factoring, it doesn't mean that the value of 5 is back in the domain. It's still out of the domain. It's like you almost have to make a record that it's gone, or that you have to make a record that it's still out, because the term, the factor that showed us it is gone. So this is still true. We've really covered ourselves by writing our domain here. But the reason I want to stress this is, if you are okay with that, and this is the simple, more simplified rational function, what is the only domain restriction kind of left standing? It's the negative 6. And that means that we have a vertical asymptote at x equals negative 6, but not at x equals 5. And the reason is, the domain restriction of 5 is still a domain restriction, but because that term canceled in top and bottom, it does not get the full kind of privilege of a vertical asymptote. At x equals 5, we have what's called a hole. A hole in the graph. I will show this in a minute, but this is an important thing. A hole is just a blip in the graph. We mark it as just an open circle, whereas a vertical asymptote at negative 6, we've seen these enough now to know that you can really see them, because the graph's behavior close to a vertical asymptote is extreme. There's our sampling. Negative 6 for the vertical asymptote, and 2 for the horizontal one. But not at 5. Why not at 5? Because the x minus 5 is canceled. And so let me just briefly talk about the algebra there. Why is this not a vertical asymptote? Well, think about what would happen if we plugged in a value close to 5. For instance, 4.99 or 5.01. I'm not sure what it would do in these two terms, right? But 4.99 going in here would be 4.99 minus 5, which would be negative 0.01. And 4.99 going in here would be the same. It would be negative 0.01, right? In other words, as you get close to the 5 but don't touch it, these terms are still the same. They're still the same number, which means that they would cancel with each other and leave a harmless 1. So they're not having a vertical asymptote pole, they're not messing with the behavior of the graph. Same is true if we test a value bigger than 5, but not equal to it. I'm not able to leave myself room here, but If this seems strange, I do encourage you to pause the video and play with it. But imagine x is 5.01. 5.01 minus 5 is 0.01, positive. 5.01 here is minus 5, is the same. So this factor becomes 0.01, this factor becomes 0.01. And what is 0.01 divided by itself? It's 1. So they cancel. And that's the idea, is because of the matching structure, as long as we don't throw in 5 itself, any other number is going to create a cancellation that just immediately flushes out of the function and doesn't do asymptotic chaos. It just makes a temporarily smooth blip in the graph. That's what we call a hole. And you can know a hole on a function on sight because they are only going to occur when, you, in factored form, you simplify a term out by canceling it with itself. That's where holes occur, and only there. So, now with all that said, let's see if we can make a sketch of this. In the next video, this is not really a graphical emphasis video, but here's going to be a rough picture of our graph. And again, I like this scaffolding so much because I know that the graph should avoid this in some way and sit on this line in another way. Before I do the sketch, just comment on this. Still vertical asymptote of negative 6, right? The implicit power of that denominator is 1.
Well, it's not squared.
Which means that as we come towards this asymptote, we should have alternating output behavior. If it goes up over here, if it goes up here, it should go down here, or vice versa. I have a little sketch of the graph prepared, so I'm just going to show you. This is what this function looks like. Crosses right through the x-axis, does something. Oh, my drawing is not perfect. And then it keeps going. So notice that, okay, this is not a perfect sketch by any means, but what I'm trying to indicate is that the horizontal asymptote seems to be in evidence. The graph is settling on the line 2 of the edges. It's definitely bending away from itself at the vertical asymptote and going up on the left side, down on the right side. That's the evidence of that 1. And again, I'm going to get this a little wrong, but at 5, the graph does this. There's the hole in the graph. It's not actually at that point. It's coming. It's here. I'll talk about how I find this. There. It eventually makes its way towards its horizontal asymptote. Yeah, not the best drawing ever. But check out how much information we can get just from having an equation in fully factored form. We know vertical asymptote and hole in the graph just from simplification and making notes, and we can draw them. We know the degree, so we know the vertical asymptote. And we have enough to make a pretty decent sketch. Now, the only other tools I want to add to this that will really help us lock down the graph are the intercepts, which we haven't talked about before. I will talk about how I plotted that hole in just a moment. So, let me rewrite this simplified function here. 2x plus 1 over x plus 6. So you can see that the graph seems to, again, don't be misled by my drawing, but it does seem to cross the y-axis somewhere, and it does seem to cross the x-axis somewhere. So the intercepts are there. There are intercepts. How do you find the y-intercept? That is by definition when x is 0. So we would say 2 times 0 plus 1 over 0 plus 6, which if you just see that through, is 1/6. So again, my drawing is not perfect, but not too difficult algebraically to say that's the coordinate. Again, my drawing is not accurately representing 1/6, but that would be, without too much difficulty, the y-intercept of that graph. How would we find the x-intercept? Well, my graph is really wrong. But let's just say, the x-intercept is when the output is 0. So if we set the output equal to 0, we just solve for x. Now the first thing we can do is multiply both sides by x plus 6, if we wanted to be 4. Because that's just gonna give us a new function, which is 0 equals the numerator. That's the idea of the x-intercepts. They're really the zeros of the numerator. That's a nice fact. If you stare at this and just solve it, subtract 1, minus 1 equals 2x, and our solution is x equals negative 1/2. So that's saying, again, my drawing is not representing this, but it should actually cross the x-axis here. I have it way over here. I just sketched it. But this is just to say that you probably should get your x and y values before you make your sketch. I didn't do that here, but it's not too bad to do, because when we get into the video on actually graphing these, we want to come into that process with knowledge of vertical asymptotes, horizontal asymptotes, any holes the graph may have, certainly the domain restrictions, and also we want to observe the multiplicities of the factors of the denominator for this kind of behavior, and we want to know the x-intercept and the y-intercept, and that will put us in a really good place to graph when we come to it. So, I'm just going to do a few more examples, but before I abandon this one completely, I am going to get the graph out of here because it's just a mess. The hole was at x equals 5, right? So that's an x value, but how do you actually find the location of the hole as a coordinate? I'll show you. We simplified the x minus 5 out of the function, which means that in this simplified function, we can use 5. And that's the way we find the coordinate of the hole. So if I say h of 5, again, I'm acknowledging that it's not in the domain. That's why it's an open circle. But at least this will allow me to find the output. I'd say 2 times 5 plus 1 over 5 plus 6, and I get 10 plus 1 over 11, which is 11 over 11, which is 1. Ah, so the coordinate of the hole, again, my drawing wasn't great, but we would have an open circle on the graph of that function at the coordinate 5, 1, because that's the output that would have happened if that x value had not been out of the domain. Cool. All right, let's look at a couple more functions algebraically. Just get some more practice at this idea of getting all the pieces that we need to prepare to graph, which we will do in the next video. New function. No bad sketches. 3x squared minus 3x. That's so long. And the denominator being x squared minus x minus 12. By the way, if you're following along with this and want to have more opportunities to hone your factoring process, by all means pause the video, see if you can, because we always want to factor everywhere and anywhere possible. Have I motivated that by now? So if you'd like to try to factor this, by all means do. Good practice. I'm just going to say that, for the sake of time, the numerator has a greatest common factor of 3x, which leaves x minus 1. And this is a pretty gentle trinomial. What two numbers multiply to negative 12 and add to negative 1? Since a is implicitly 1 here, I can kind of jump to the end. I believe it should be minus 4 and positive 3. So there's the factor. Put the 3x in parentheses if you like. Okay. Again, factoring is such an important skill for all these reasons. So what can we do with this new version of the function? We can see so much. First of all, let me just ask about domain and if there are any cancellations top to bottom, because that is the lookout for holes in the graph versus vertical asymptotes, right? 3x and x minus 1 are a pair. X minus 4 and x plus 3 are factors. Nothing matches. So this graph will have no holes. Whew, that's nice. One less thing to concern ourselves about. But what now can we say about the rest? Vertical asymptotes are going to be the zeros of the denominator, the kind of visual evidence of the domain restrictions. And we can see that x cannot be 4. So let me get note to domain here. x can't be 4, right? 4. And negative 3. Those are out. We can see why. And because both of those factors that tell us that are left standing at the end, they didn't cancel, they are both vertical asymptotes. So the vertical asymptotes are x equals 4 and x equals negative 3. I'm not going to draw this, but once we are through this, certainly I encourage you to visually check this using technology or Desmos if you want to see a nice rational function that seems like it should have more than one vertical asymptote. So that's that. Now, what do we know about the horizontal asymptote? Does it even have one? Because in the last video we saw that it might, but oblique asymptotes are a thing too, depending on the degrees. I like this form, but this is the one time I'd say where the original unfactored form is a little bit easier for me to find the horizontal asymptote, because I can just see degree, degree, 2, 2, they're the same. Ratio of the coefficients is 3. So the horizontal asymptote is y equals 3. And again, this is nice because we can draw vertical dotted lines at these, a horizontal dotted line here. We've got great scaffolding to build our function. And we know that there are no holes. So what's left to check for? The intercepts. We'll get to the intercepts, but also multiplicity of the factors in the denominator are both 1, right? And I want to, and in fact, it's 1 here and 1 here. Good, so the multiplicities of the numerator factors are 1, and the multiplicities of the denominator's factors are both 1. This is important that they do different things, numerator to denominator. So, what will these say? These will tell me that because they're both powers of 1, as the graph approaches those asymptotes, we don't know if they're coming at it from above or below, but they will go in alternate directions instead of the power of 2 where we saw matching directions. As it approaches both of these asymptotes, the graph is going to do something like this or this, bending away from itself like a magnet. And we expect that just because these are powers of 1 and our denominator domain restrictions are vertical asymptotes. So that's also good information. Now let's talk about the intercepts and what else we can say about them. How do we find the y-intercept? It's not easy, but it's not too bad. We just plug in 0 for x, right? Which is not a domain restriction, so we can do it. 3 times 0 times 0 minus 1 all over 0 minus 4 times 0 plus 3. Well, the denominator is negative 12. That's negative 1, but that's 0. So it all is 0. This means that if x is 0, y is 0, the coordinate is the origin, and we know that that's an x and y-intercept, the only coordinate that's both. So the y-intercept is the origin, and we kind of found one of our x-intercepts for free. But don't stop there, because while that's perfectly good for the y-intercept, x-intercepts are this is true from polynomial study. The x-intercepts, the roots, the zeros, come from this polynomial on top being set equal to 0, which means that this piece, if we can make it 0, we're going to have another x-intercept, right? Generally speaking, if we can make the numerator equal to 0, we have found an x-intercept. This is the one we saw here. But what number makes this factor 0? X equals 1. So if x equals 1, certainly check this, it's going to make this term 0, which means it doesn't matter what this term is, it'll become 0 by multiplication, and the denominator is not going to become 0 because this is not a domain restriction. So that's a nice fast-track way to say this is another x-intercept, 1, 0. This is both an x and y-intercept, and here's another x-intercept, so we've got all this information about the graph. If we had x and y-axis with all this scaffolding, we could plot these points. And the last thing I want to say in this video, I'm going to do one more example, is that what were the multiplicities of these zeros? This is very consistent with what we studied with polynomials. The multiplicity here was 1, and the multiplicity here was 1. The reason I stress that is, just like with polynomials, the multiplicity tells you the behavior of the graph at the x-intercepts. These multiplicities will mean that it should essentially cut straight through the graph like a linear function at these two coordinates, and it will. The rational functions are going to obey that principle. So just knowing that the multiplicities of these zeros up here, the factors up here, are both ones, tells us a little bit about the behavior of the graph, this insane unknown rational function. We know, though, that at these points, it's going to cut straight through the x-axis, not bounce off, not shimmy through like a cubic. It's going to go straight through because of the multiplicities. All this is good information. I'm going to put it to use in the next video where we graph these. So, one more example. Last one, function t, defined by the rational, defined as a rational function. Here we go. Once again, I'm going to get it in factored form, just for analysis this time. I don't want to put myself through the task of factoring this one at this hour. X plus 5 and x minus 2. Here's the rational function. And by now you are seeing that we really can make some immediate observations, starting with domain. What numbers are out of the domain? What numbers can x not equal? Minus 5 and positive 2. Right. That's true. That's true for the rest of this function's life. Now we may, before we talk about the horizontal asymptotes, see if these are both going to be vertical asymptotes or if one of them might be a whole, and that has to do with, is there a factor on top and bottom that simplifies away, cancels? Be careful. These look very similar, but they are not the same because the sign is different, so they don't cancel. Similar thing here. These look, they tempt us, but they are not the same. So nothing cancels. This one has no holes also. And again, holes in a graph are no big deal. It just means one fewer vertical asymptote, and instead it's just a little blip in the graph, and we can find it the way we did the last one. But this one has none. So we should expect the graph of this rational function to have two vertical asymptotes. Where are they? X equals negative 5, and x equals 2. They correspond to the values that make the denominator 0 that didn't simplify away. Cool. There's the vertical asymptote. What are the horizontal asymptotes, if there is one? This is where we have to put our degree hat and do a little bit of mental foiling. Without fully foiling, x plus 2 times itself, that x will multiply by itself and become an x squared. And then that x squared will at some point meet this x, and it'll leave a leading term of x cubed plus all the rest. Hopefully that's okay. Now, what about this denominator? Here's just x plus 5. No power there. 1. But this x minus 2 is being squared, so it will multiply, it will foil and create an x squared piece, and then that x squared embedded in that is going to multiply by this x and also make a leading term of x cubed, with all the other details being lesser terms. So what can we say about the horizontal asymptote? Here our n is 3, our m is 3, they're the same. If they're the same, the horizontal asymptote is the ratio of their lead coefficients, 1 divided by 1, this one. This one will have its end behavior at the line y equals 1, as x gets really large or really small. So much to be gained from just analyzing the function in factor 4. What else do we want? There's no holes, we've got domain, we've got vertical and horizontal asymptotes. We want to talk about, or set an expectation about, well, let's get the intercepts just out of the way. Y-intercept. This time it won't be the origin, I don't think. We find it by plugging x equals 0. T of 0 is 0 plus 2 squared times 0 minus 5 over 0 plus 5 and 0 minus 2 squared. 0 minus 2 squared is 2 squared, which is 4. And this is negative 5. It's positive 5. Oops. 5. And this is negative 2 times itself is 4. Oh, this is nicer than I expected. 4 cancels, and 5. But negative 5 divided by 5 is negative 1, so we have a y value of negative 1. So the y-intercept is this coordinate, 0. And that just tells us something more about our graph. What about the x-intercept, or x-intercepts are the roots, the zeros? X-intercept. For the sake of time, remember, this is really, we're not going to be, it's not going to be negative 5 or 2, they're out. We're trying to make the numerator equal to 0. Because 0 divided by something that isn't 0 is 0. So what x value makes this piece 0? Negative 2. So I throw that coordinate. What x value makes this piece 0? Positive 5, and again, that's safe. So the other x-intercept is 5, 0. Those two x values both make the top equal to 0. So that is all good information to graph. Our y-intercept is 0 minus 1. The thing I want to hold on before we end this video is behaviors of the x-intercepts, behaviors around the asymptotes. So what is the graph going to do as it hits these two x-intercepts? Well, this one came from here, and its multiplicity was 2. So we don't know if it's going to come from above or below, but we should expect some kind of bounce behavior as it hits that point. With everything else going on, we should expect that because of what we know about multiplicities. And at this x-intercept, because it has a multiplicity of 1, we should expect it to cut through, up or down, depending. Again, in the next video, we're going to put all this together. But we are just getting our heads straight and setting expectations about what do we know without any visual aid. We know a lot. So those are the behaviors we should expect at the x-intercepts. What should we expect around the vertical asymptotes? In other words, will the graph sort of come towards the vertical asymptote and bend away from itself, or will they both go up or both go down, or will they be the same in the same direction? It's about the multiplicities around those asymptotes. Around negative 5, power of 1, so around that x value, we should expect some sort of alternating direction, up or down or down and up, like we saw in the original right side function on the whiteboard. What about at x equals 2? What should the graph do? Actually, notice how that's not too dissimilar from the original function I had, x plus 2 squared. You recall at the beginning of the video, that was when the graph was going up like this around the vertical asymptote, because anytime you have a power of 2, you have matching behavior. Now, we should expect that here, but what we don't know is if it's going up around the line, or if it's going down and down, but the important thing is that because of that power, it's going the same direction from both sides, same direction up or down from both sides, whichever one it is. It's not going one direction and in one side and the other direction on the other side. So in our next video, we are going to bring all of these skills, all of this knowledge to bear on actually sketching pretty decent graphs of rational functions from their equations. But just to recap, if you can stare at a rational function and factor it and get it as factored as possible, you have all this insight even before you start drawing. You know the domain restrictions. You know vertical asymptotes, horizontal asymptotes, potential holes, and now we have the added benefit of the intercepts, the behaviors around the x-intercepts, and the behaviors around the vertical asymptotes. So in our next video, we will put all this together and graph these functions.